Hey, it's Professor Dave. Let's try some optimization problems.
He knows a lot about all kinds of stuff, Professor Dave explains.
One of the most common phrases you will hear in a mathematics classroom is, "Why do I need to know this?" While I certainly can't promise that every person watching this will use math every day in their chosen careers, it is very easy to demonstrate the endless real-world applications of calculus, which allow anyone to see exactly how powerful this discipline is when it comes to solving complex problems. And not just in physics, this applies to business too. We may be trying to decipher a business strategy that will minimize manufacturing costs or maximize profits. We may be trying to minimize the distance traveled or maximize an area of property. In any of these cases, we should notice the words minimize and maximize. These words mean that we are looking for a function's local maximum or minimum, something we already learned how to do. Let's look at an example, and I'll show you what I mean. Let's say that a farmer has 2,400 meters of fencing and wants to use this to enclose some rectangular plot of land by a river. The farmer needs only three sides for the fence, as the plot can remain open to the river itself, and they want the biggest plot possible. What will be the dimensions for this plot that will maximize its area? Well, let's take a few guesses just for fun. Say we go 100 meters up from the river on either side, leaving 2,200 meters of fence to connect them. Calculating the area of the rectangle, that's 220,000 square meters. We can probably do better than this. How about a square with 800 meters per side? That will give us 640,000 square meters. Definitely an improvement, but is this really the best we can do? We could guess and check all day, but why don't we just do some calculus instead? Well, first, let's assign some variables. Let's call these two sides x and this side y. We care about this area, and since this is a rectangle, area equals x times y. We also know that these three sides must add up to 2,400, because that's all the fencing we have to work with. So let's say that 2x plus y equals 2,400. Let's solve for one of these variables, perhaps y. Y must equal 2,400 minus 2x. Now we can plug this expression in for y in our area equation, and we get that the area equals x times the quantity 2,400 minus 2x. We distribute the x, and this is what we get. Now we said that we want to get the biggest area possible. That means we want the maximum possible value of this function. Well, we learned that to find a maximum or minimum, we must take the first derivative and see where it equals zero. So let's do that. The first derivative will be 2,400 minus 4x. We can just set this equal to zero, move things around a bit to solve for x, and we get x equals 600. Area will be at a maximum when x equals 600 meters, so these two sides are 600, making this side 1,200, and the maximum possible area of the rectangle will be 720,000. So as you can see, taking a quick derivative and setting it equal to zero is much easier than doing guess and check all day. All we had to do was draw a diagram, identify the unknown, or what we are trying to solve for, express this in terms of algebraic relationships, and then do calculus to find a maximum or minimum value. Let's try another one. Say a canned good manufacturer wants to mass produce a product in a cylindrical can that must have a volume of 1.5 liters. In order to keep costs as low as possible, they want to find the least amount of material that can be used to achieve this particular volume. What amount will this be? Well, this question is asking something about the surface area of the can, as that will tell us how much material is needed to make one can. How can we find the surface area of the cylinder? Well, we have two circular bases. Those have an area of pi r squared. So putting them together, that's 2 pi r squared. Then we have this whole section, which is essentially a rectangle folded back on itself. If we were to unfold this, it would have a base length of 2 pi r, as that's the circumference of the base, and a height, which we can represent as h. The area of the rectangle will simply be their product, 2 pi r times h. The total surface area will therefore be the sum of these two, or 2 pi r squared plus 2 pi r times h. Now, we would prefer to have everything in terms of r, so what can we do with h? Well, let's recall that we know something about the volume of this cylinder. That must be 1.5 liters, or 1,500 cubic centimeters. How does volume relate to all this? Well, the volume of a cylinder is the area of the base times the height, and in this case, that's pi r squared h. So let's use this expression to solve for h in terms of r. Dividing both sides by pi r squared, we get 1,500 over pi r squared. So let's plug that in for h in our surface area equation. Then we can distribute this term, and we end up with 2 pi r squared plus 3,000 over r. Now, if this is the equation that gives us the surface area of the can in terms of its radius, and we want to minimize this function, or find the smallest amount of material that will yield this volume, all we have to do is take the derivative and set it equal to 0. The derivative of the first term is 4 pi r. And then for this second term, if we rewrite this as 3,000 r to the negative 1, we get negative 1 times 3,000 r to the negative 2. So we end up subtracting 3,000 over r squared. If we get a common denominator here, we can combine the terms, and we are left with this, 4 pi r cubed minus 3,000 over r squared. As we said, we want to find where this derivative equals 0, because that will give us the lowest point on the function, where the surface area goes from decreasing to increasing. So let's set this derivative equal to 0 and solve for r. If we multiply both sides by the denominator, it will just go away, since we are multiplying by 0. Then we have to add 3,000 to both sides. Divide by 4 to get 750. Then we can divide by pi. And lastly, we take the cube root. That leaves us with the cube root of 750 over pi. And although that may not look pretty, that's our answer for the ideal radius of the can that will keep costs at a minimum. We can then plug this into another equation to solve for the height of the can as well, and that will give us the ideal dimensions of the can. The last thing we want to be aware of is that when the derivative of a function is 0, there is a maximum or minimum at that point. But we certainly must be able to know whether it is a maximum or minimum. If we think we are finding the minimum cost of something, but we are really finding the maximum cost, our boss will be very angry with us. So let's learn something called the second derivative test. Wherever a derivative is equal to 0, we can take the derivative again to get the second derivative. If the second derivative is positive at that value, then the point is a local minimum, because that part of the curve must be concave up. If instead the second derivative is negative at that value, the point is a local maximum, because that part of the curve must be concave down. If our answers make perfect sense without doing this, it may not be necessary, but if in doubt, it doesn't take much time to check the numbers in this manner. So between related rates and optimization problems, we should now understand the power of calculus and the wide variety of its applications. We will discover more things we can do with calculus later. For now, let's check comprehension. Thank you. Thanks for watching, guys. Subscribe to my channel for more tutorials. Support me on Patreon so I can keep making content. And as always, feel free to email me, ProfessorDaveExplains@gmail.com.